Good evening. Thanks for coming out on this wonderful, blustery night. We are really excited to have this ally training, and we're going to get started. All right. I got distracted by all the wonderful people in the room. I'm Carlin Crowley, a professor of English and Women's and Gender Studies here, and the director of the Cassandra Voss Center.
Hi everybody, I'm Jaime Gonzalez, and I'm the new incoming assistant director of the Center.
Kayla Vu, program coordinator at Cassandra Voss Center.
You do have to clap for me.
I'm Anna Zarnik Niemeyer, and I'm the outgoing assistant director at the Cassandra Voss Center.
So, a note about tonight. As you know, at every Cassandra Voss Center program, we share our core values with you. So, we are scholarship-driven, meaning we are grounded in the field of women's and gender studies. We are welcoming of all people into the space and into the conversation. We are innovative, meaning all of our programs strive to be cutting edge. And finally, we are fun. We believe that delight resists tyranny, and when there's joy in the conversation, people want to be in that conversation. We welcome you here tonight for this conversation. If you're following on social media, please like us on Facebook, and we'll like you back in real life. And the hashtag for this year is #UntiedMasculinityNow.
And we also like to start all our events by thanking all of our community partners, specifically Humana, who's gone out of their way to videotape this nice ally training, and we'll be submitting it into the Media Education Foundation, which will hopefully mean it will turn into a national publication and serve for a lot of further conversations and training. So thank you all for helping us out.
Watch if you aren't here tonight. So how the night will go, Dr. Brode is giving a lecture for about 40 to 45 minutes. He'll have about 10 minutes of questions, Q&A, and so we should be out in about an hour.
Hi again, everyone. Again, I'm Kiel, the program coordinator at the Cassandra Voss Center. Dr. Harry Brode is professor of sociology at the University of Northern Iowa and joined St. Norbert College as the first ever long distinguished visiting scholar in masculinities studies, where Brode is widely recognized as a founding figure in the field. You may have heard him at the National Masculinity Summit through the Cassandra Voss Center on November 2nd and 3rd, or through his many presentations and trainings this semester, including the first ever SNC course on men and masculinity and a bi-weekly masculinity study group. Brode received his PhD in philosophy at the University of California, San Diego. He is the author or editor of 8 books, including The Making of Masculinities, The New Men's Studies, A Mensch Among Men, Explorations in Jewish Masculinity, and White Men Challenging Racism, 35 Personal Stories. His interests in research and teaching include gender studies, Jewish studies, social and political theory, and critical studies of masculinities, whitenesses, and heterosexualities. Brode has spoken nationally as a part of gender violence prevention campaigns. His film, Asking For It, The Ethics and Erotics of Sexual Consent, is considered essential viewing to understand the concept of affirmative consent. Please join us in welcoming Dr. Harry Brode.
Thank you. I am honored that so many of you came out on a cold, rainy evening like this, so thank you. Let me begin by breaking the first rule of public speaking, which is that you're supposed to start by telling people how exciting it is to be here and how much you've been looking forward to it, and all of that is true, and something else is true. Because the election events of earlier this month, no, last month already, isn't it? Okay, time flies. The election results really put me into a tailspin, and I'm sure I'm not the only one. I also hope there are a significant number of people in the room who were not disheartened by the election, because one of the things I want to be talking about is we need to speak with people who disagree with us. So I really hope we are not a relatively monolithic group here. But there was a period where I really just wasn't feeling it. You've got to be able to summon a certain spirit of optimism and hope to do this ally work. And it just wasn't there. So there was one morning when I was on the verge of canceling it and saying, I can't pull this off. And that fortunately didn't last long, because I said, well, it's relatively easy to hold on to your principles when things are going well for you. It's when things get hard that's the challenge. That's when you need to hold to principle. You need to hold on to your principles for dear life, because that's what's going to get you through. So I'm going to give the talk that I was going to give, which is a forward-looking, optimistic view of being an ally and social change. And I am aware, it does feel to me that the ground has shifted in what people think of in terms of being an ally. That before the election, people who had really strong commitments to thinking of what it means to be a social justice ally were thinking about in forward-looking terms, making the world a better place. And I'm now picking up, we've shifted into defensive mode, and I'll say we. That being an ally now feels almost like being a human shield for those who are feeling threatened and under assault. And I want to acknowledge that. And I am not under the illusion that what I'm going to be speaking about tonight is the most important thing to be spoken about. It's clear to me that it's not. It's clear to me that being an ally, standing in solidarity with the marginalized and oppressed and those who feel threatened, is the essential task of the moment. But I want to challenge us to look beyond the urgency of the moment and hold to long-term social change strategy. So that's going to be my focus this evening. I want to first, before we talk about how to be an effective social justice ally, which is the title we gave this, also subtitle, Working From and Against Privilege, and I want to talk about all that. Before we get to how, I want to talk about why, because I think that's important, and sometimes we sort of assume that, and I do want to emphasize the why before we get to the how. The most obvious why is the demands of justice, and that really is sufficient. The demands of justice and equality demand that we stand as allies. But a friend of mine said that, from whom I learned a great deal, being an ally is not something we have to do, it's something we get to do. It's a privilege in the positive sense of privilege. So we need to understand our personal stake in working as allies. At the risk of seeming superficial, we need to see our own stake, our own self-interest in the work we do. My study of history and social change movements leads me to say that, first of all, we need to understand we're in this for the long haul. This is not a quick fix. And if we don't see our personal stake in the changes we are supporting, energy simply fails. We cannot sustain ourselves for the long haul unless we see our personal stake in the transformations we seek. So the moral imperative for justice is absolutely enough and sufficient. But if you want to put it this way, one needs to, I look for a moral imperative to go beyond moral imperatives. There is a moral imperative to see more than the morality of the issue, to see our interest in the issue. It's not a rescue operation. Right? That's part of why I want to say we're not doing this for someone else. And as important as ally work is, I want to say we need to stop one step short of saying it's necessary. Because I think we need to hold to the principle that the oppressed are perfectly capable of liberating themselves, thank you very much. Right? They do not depend, they do not need those of us who are in dominant groups and situating ourselves as allies. It's sure going to go a lot more quickly. There's going to be a lot less pain, right? We're going to get there more quickly. It'll be more smooth. But we need to take ourselves off center stage and be clear that we are actually not necessary to the project. We will be pushed out of the way if we don't get on the train, right? So that's part of the picture too. But when I sort of hold back as an ally to marginalized groups and allow for the oppressed to come to leadership, it is essential that I am holding back not out of any self-deprecation, not out of any sense that I don't deserve to speak because my group has already spoken so much or something like that. This is my empowered choice as an ally to assist marginalized leadership to come to the fore. This is how I choose to exercise my strength, not to dominate the conversation, not to take leadership. And the attitude with which we allow other leadership to step forward matters. It matters that I do that as personal empowerment, not as self-deprecation in any way. My allies do not need me to self-deprecate myself. My allies need me to be the strongest, best version of myself that I can be, to be fully empowered, right? And that's one of the reasons I choose to be an ally, I work as an ally, situate myself that way, and recommend that to you. It's the best way I know to produce the best version of myself. It's the best way I know to hold my own feet to the fire and make sure that I act on my commitments so that when I don't feel like interrupting someone sexist or racist or heterosexist or anti-Semitic or whatever comment, and I'm really not up for going to the rally or making the phone call or writing the check or whatever it is, I've got this still small voice in the back of my head telling me, you know, you have publicly said that people need to do this. And nobody likes to think of themselves as a hypocrite. So I find it personally empowering. It's clear to me, and I made this comment at the Mass Masculinity Summit, I say what I say because it's what I need to hear. Right? This is an act of self-empowerment. There's a story told by Rabbi Arthur Waskow. I published an essay of his in a book I edited called A Mensch Among Men. Mensch is Yiddish for technically human being, but is always used in the sense of a moral human being, like you were real mensch, you took care of me when I was sick. So in this essay, he tells the story of one of the prophets of the ancient period wandering the desert, issuing the call to come to righteousness and justice, as the prophets do. And after 15 years of this wandering and trying to rally the people, somebody asks him, you've been doing this for 15 years, nothing has really changed. Why do you keep doing this? And he said, well, for the first 7 years, I was trying to change them. For the second 7 years, I was trying to prevent them from changing me. That's where the story ends. My personal view is that the real teaching there is that the question is asked after the 15th year, not after the 14th. And my view that in that additional year is the learning for the prophet and the teaching for us, that these are two sides of the same coin. that the struggle to improve the world is simply a matter of keeping our own integrity. When I talk about privilege, what I'm talking about very simply is unearned advantage that comes to me because of my membership in a dominant group. It's the easiest way I know to translate what privilege is. And privilege is this flip side of oppression. And when most of us think of oppression, we have this model in our heads that society is a level playing field in general, except for the fact that some of us are oppressed. That's the root word of oppression, pressing down. So if we were simply to remove oppression, then everybody would rise to the level playing field and all would be well. That's a model that only sees half the picture. I want to offer you a different visual image for privilege and oppression, and that is, instead of the level playing field, the scales of justice. You know, the balance scales that Lady Justice Hull holds, and she's blindfolded, not to illustrate that justice is blind, but that justice is impartial, doesn't give preference to the particular person who is standing in front to be evaluated. On those balanced scales of justice, if one side is oppressed, the other side is necessarily raised up. That's privilege. And some of us are relatively trained to see oppression, but we are much less skilled at seeing privilege. So when I can be affectionate with my heterosexual partner in public and not worried that I'm going to be followed into an alley and beaten to a pulp because of that, that's straight privilege. When I can enter a store and dress as shabbily as I want and go to the expensive jewelry or electronics section and not be followed by the house detective, that's privilege. There are all sorts of daily examples of that, and it's just not as visible to us. We need to get much better at seeing our privileges and how we benefit from them. I used to take great personal pride in positioning myself as an ally. I was being so moral and ethical and all that. And in more recent years, as I have moved into taking the responsibilities of being an elder in the community, things have gotten much simpler for me. Now it's simply a cost-benefit analysis. I have benefited from the ways in which I am a member of privileged and dominant groups. And I believe in paying my debts. It's just balancing the balance sheet. It's just giving back. It's just good manners is all it is. I'm not trying to be extra ethical. I'm just being minimally moral, and trying to live a life of integrity. And it's all gotten much simpler for me in recent years. And I recommend that to you. Having said that, we are at a moment where the emphasis is rightly on standing in solidarity with the marginalized, with those who feel threatened. I want to switch to talk about, in my view, those of us who carry dominant group identities of whatever sorts. And let me say, all of us carry many social identities, in some of which we are in the dominant group, in some of which we are in the subordinated group. We have different identities by race and class and gender and sexual orientation and religion and able-bodiedness and physical appearance and geographic region and age and all sorts of categories that divide us in hierarchical ways. But when we are in dominant groups, our key work is with others of our own group. And that's really what I want to spend time focusing on, because that is where I think we have a distinctive role to play. So in addition to the general demands of being a just, moral human being, there's a specific role in working from and against privilege. So that's the subtitle. For me, the justice imperatives are particularly strong, just to share some of my identities, situate myself historically. When I claim what to me are my core identities, I situate myself as a child of two major historical events. And that is that I am a child of the 60s, was an undergraduate on a college campus from 68 to 72, which were really interesting years to be on a college campus. So I'm happy to claim that legacy and all that comes with it. And then I'm a child of Holocaust survivors. Both my parents were European Jews who survived the war years in Europe. I was born in Berlin after the war in 51. English is not my first language. I spoke German first. And actually, I've written and spoken about my parents as what I call temporary Holocaust survivors, where what I mean is they survived the war years themselves, but they both died younger than I think they would have had they not had to go through the hardships and traumas of those years. My mother died at 48 and my father at 58, both of heart attacks. So when I passed the age that my father had reached, we could talk about what a milestone that was for me. So let me talk about the main theme I want to talk about with you this evening, working from dominant group identities. We all carry all sorts of stereotypes and negative views and ideas about other groups. This is not our fault. We did not choose to have these views. It comes in with the air we breathe. This is social pollution that all of us had no choice but to inhale. And it's always right under the skin, ready to pop out at any provocation if we're angry about anything. Right? So my go-to example is I'm driving along the highway and someone cuts me off and I go, that jerk. And if it's a woman, it's woman driver. Right? And it's right there. It's got nothing to do with what I actually think of women or women drivers or anything. It came in with the air we breathe, and it's ready to pop out at any moment, unbidden, unsolicited by me. Right? So if someone says something that I find oppressive to another group or to my group, the key is that I'm not smarter or better than they are. I'm just luckier. I wasn't in the wrong place at the wrong time when this particular bit of social pollution was circulating. I was in other wrong places at wrong times, and I inhaled other junk that I need to deal with. All of us have inhaled this junk, and we need to clear out our lungs and get rid of it. But I don't have that particular piece of it. So I have a clearer vision. Right? When we are talking about being an ally, the stance that's necessary is one of full respect for the person, understanding there but for fortune go I. Right? And that is absolutely key to me, the distinction between what a person says and the person who says it. I can radically disagree with what the person says and still have full respect for the person who says it. And we really need, it is absolutely essential to hold to that distinction between the person and what they say. Because if I think that I don't have this terrible view that I just heard them express, and I run in with all this terrific enlightened information I have to enlighten them, to correct them, right? If I'm coming in because I think I'm smarter or I'm better than they are, and I have all this terrific information to give them, they're not going to hear any of it. All they're going to hear is my arrogance and they'll be right, because that's what it is. If I approach them with anything other than a stance of complete equality as person and respect, there is no foundation for communication. So I can radically disagree with what the person says, but still have respect for the person. By the way, this is the foundation of all philosophies of nonviolent resistance, whether we're talking about Gandhi and his comments about the liberation of India would have been impossible without the British sense of fair play, whether we're talking about King's call to conscience, we are talking about what Lincoln and the classic second inaugural address referred to as the better angels of our nature. We rely for social change on appealing to that portion of the other. We rely on the reachability of their humanity. You've probably heard the phrase, nature abhors a vacuum, right? Nature, things will rush to fill in when there's a vacuum. The mind abhors a vacuum as well. If I engage in any kind of intellectual, verbal, or physical combat with the other person, they're directed at me. They're trying to figure out how to defeat me in this combat. That makes them cling all more defensively and strongly to this idea that I'm trying to change. I want them to change their mind. If I don't engage in combat with them, if I ally myself with them, and here's the kicker of being an ally, I am an ally to the very person who made the terrible remark that I want to change. That's the key of functioning as a social justice ally, which to me means functioning as a social change activist. And what I'm doing is aligning myself with the person against what has been done to them, against these terrible, oppressive, mistaken views that have been inflicted upon them. I am the ally to the person who has had this done to them. When I discover my own oppressive stereotypes, views, and we all have our biases, right? One reaction is to feel guilty about it. I feel terrible. We don't want to admit we have these terrible views inside of us. If you really take this view that I'm trying to express, that these stereotypes, these oppressive ideas are inflicted upon us, then someone's going to have to explain to me why on earth I should feel guilty about what has been done to me. I just don't get it. I do not understand why we should feel guilty about what has been done to us, and we have inevitably had to breathe in with the air we breathe. Yeah. So I enlist myself as an ally to the very person who said this terrible thing, and I do so by not engaging in combat with them, right? Because like I said, if I engage in combat, I draw their attention to me. If I don't, the mind abhors a vacuum. The mind has no place to go but to turn inward upon itself. And from that self-reflection comes change. And that's how we make social change. Change is self-change. And we enlist ourselves in assisting the person to undergo the self-examination that will lead to change. As I said, this is the foundation of all nonviolent resistance strategies. I need to get to the point where I can see how they got to this terrible view to which I object. I need to get to the point where I see we have a conversation and I'm inquiring about how can they think such a thing? Why do they think that? But not with the putting down, how do you think that? How can you possibly think that? The dismissive tone, but a general spirit of inquiry. Tell me, what are you thinking of when you said this thing? How'd you get there? And if I don't get to the point where I can see that, oh, if I was coming from where that person's coming from, if I had that person's experiences and background, I too would not necessarily have this view. We still have free will. We still make different interpretations. but this view would appear to me as a reasonable option among the wide range of human possibilities of possible views I could take. I need to get to the point where this terrible thing they said, I can see how if I were, how this would appear as a live option to a person of intelligence and goodwill if I had had those experiences. Right? And then we have the grounds for a respectful conversation. Because then I got it. I got you. I got how you get there. Then and only then can we have a further conversation that might go something like, you know, I think about this differently. Because when I think about this issue, I'm thinking of these experiences. And it could be personal experiences, it could be things I read, could be things I heard. Would you like to hear about what's going on in my mind when I think about this issue and come to a different conclusion? And they might decline the offer, in which case I hope we can continue the conversation some other time. And they might accept the offer. And now, instead of trying to convince each other of something, engaging in combat, we are engaged in a mutual exploration of our experiences. Here's your experience that gave rise to your view. Here's my experience that gave rise to my view. Maybe we can have a further conversation about whose experience we think was more likely to give us accurate insight into whatever the issue is that we're talking about. We are engaged in a mutually respectful conversation, and out of that can come change. You solicit their story. Change happens person to person. Change happens story to story. Change happens heart to heart. We do not talk anybody into change. We listen people into change. We listen people into change. Social change is a listening project where I give the other person the full credit and respect for trying to make sense of their life as I give myself for mine. This requires that I've done my homework, that I know how come I have my ideas, and I don't just, I'm smarter, I'm better. Right? I need to be able to trace my ideas back to where I got them from. Instead of taking all this credit for my terrific ideas, I'm smarter, I'm more moral. I spoke earlier about not accepting guilt for one's negative ideas, things we don't like, the biases we have. That's the flip side of not taking credit for things we do like about ourselves. Right? And all the what we've learned from the feminist movement, the slogan is the personal is political. This is a case where we need to depersonalize the political. It's not our doing. We are the influences of all sorts of other factors that have shaped us. So if you want to take all this pride about how smart and enlightened you are, you have these terrific ideas, you're also going to have to accept the guilt and blame for the negative ideas you have that you don't like. My advice, personally, from me to you, drop all of it. Right? We can lay that burden down. It really is a better way to live. The more you get your own ego out of your own way, the better off you will be, and the better off we will all be. So that's part of my recommendation for being a social justice ally and for leading a better life when we do so. Some people here heard me made a comment about something I do in my classroom, which also has to do with separating the person from what the person says. Sometimes in a classroom situation, a student will say something, and the other students are ready to pounce. They've said something that the students feel are racist or sexist or heterosexist or whatever, and you can feel the tension, you know, build in the room, and they're ready to jump on the person. And at that point, I will turn to the person who said it and say, would you like some feedback on how what you said is being heard? There appears to be a reaction in the room. You probably noticed it too. I've never had a student decline the invitation. Right? And then other students, you see the tension go out of their bodies, because they're going to have a chance to speak. right? But they're speaking not in terms of you miserable so-and-so. They're speaking in terms of here's how this impacted me. Right? And then we again have, you've created the conditions for respectful conversation in which learning takes place. Right? And I always make a point to thank the student who said it to validate their courage. Because I say something along the lines of, I have a hunch you may have known that this was going to be a controversial comment. And thank you for modeling that courage for the class. We really need to have these honest conversations if we're going to get anywhere in this classroom and have the conversations we need to have. So that is a great service to the class. I had a friend from whom I learned a great deal about these things, who if someone said something oppressive in her presence, instead of panicking the way many of us do, oh my God, what am I going to say? Right? She would be delighted that someone said something oppressive in her presence. And I mentioned this at the summit the other day too. First of all, better they said it in my presence who has an idea how to handle it than they said it when there isn't someone around, or even worse, if they said it directed to someone in the oppressed, marginalized group. And then she would be delighted because, well, now we have something to talk about. We don't have to waste time talking about the weather. We have a mutual interest. Right? I'm interested in the topic of racism, say, whatever, because I have my social justice commitments. You're interested in it because you're the one who brought it up. Right? Clearly you're interested in this topic. This is not a barrier, this is a bridge. Of course we're on different sides. That's why you need bridges. That's why you build bridges. Right? So this is a source of connection. Right? This is an opportunity to enter into deeper relationship with someone by virtue of having a meaningful conversation about a meaningful issue. And the way most of us will react, we think, oh my God, somebody said something, we got to shut it down. And I want to say exactly the opposite. You don't want to shut them down. You want to open them up. You want to engage and assist them to self-reflect. You want to hear their story. You want to open minds by opening hearts, story to story, person to person. Right? We need to connect across differences. I'll tell you another story about connecting and missed connections across differences. I'm here now. Normally, I'm at the University of Northern Iowa. And sometimes I tell a story in a class where I can't tell you how many times I've heard African-American students and older persons who have come up to the Midwest from the American South. And everybody tells the story a little bit differently, but they'll say something like, you know, in the South, if someone's going to have a problem with me, I can tell. I know what's going on. It's annoying. It's restrictive. I hate it, all of that. But I know how to deal with it. It doesn't bog me down. It doesn't get in my way. I know how to confront it or work my way around it or something. It doesn't confuse me, throw me. I come to Iowa and people seem nice. They say hello. But in the meantime, nobody's talking to me. And I feel like the ground is not solid beneath my feet. I don't get it. I don't know what's going on. And I try to explain what I've learned from white students is their attitude is, I reached out, I said hello, now let me go spend time with people I'm more comfortable with. What more do you want? Right? So the white students are not getting that this is a repeated experience for people of color. They say hello, they seem friendly, and then they're done with me. Right? And the white students are really puzzled. They go, you mean exactly when I'm doing my best not to be racist, I say hello? That's when I'm being racist? This is how what gets described as Iowa nice or Midwest nice, this is how Midwest racism looks. It's nice. Okay? And it's under the heading of being nice and reaching out. And the niceness ends up feeling oppressive to those who are on the receiving end of the forced niceness. Now, I am not telling persons of white racial identity to go grab the first person of color you see and say, will you be my friend? I want to be anti-racist. Right? I mean, this would be a new and very peculiar form of racism. Right? So that's not the name of the game. As I said, you are not responsible for the negative feelings you have. So if it's awkward, it's uncomfortable, you're afraid of making a mistake, you're not responsible for that. If you've grown up in relatively monolithic environments, and actually no environment is really as monolithic as we all spend a lot of time and effort trying to make it seem. If you really dig beneath the surface, there's a lot more diversity than we're willing to let on. But so you're awkward and scared and all of that. It's not your fault. But there are all sorts of other contexts where you're awkward and shy and scared, and you've learned how to break through it. Maybe there's a romantic interest. Maybe you're doing job networking. You've learned some way to break through your inhibitions. You don't let it get in your way. Here you do. It's okay with you that we continue to live in our racial silos, and we don't break through and have cross-racial friendships. That's your choice not to invest your effort there in breaking through the barriers that are keeping you from making connection. For that choice, you are responsible. You are responsible for having set your priorities. You are responsible for making the choice not to reach out and to connect to people across differences. So I said, it's not about, grabbing somebody, will you be my friend? There are other mistakes that are real easy to make that I want to talk about, because this is not a mistake-free process. We're going to step on each other's toes. And we need to think about how to deal with our mistakes and clean them up. So suppose someone says to me, what you just said is oppressive, is sexist, racist, heterosexist, anti-Semitic, classist, disability discrimination, whatever it is. That's a communication that has two parts. The first part of that communication is simply, ouch. What you said hurt me. It's not a complex message. The second part of that communication is, and I think the way that I'm hurt has something to do with the fact that you and I are members of different social identity groups that carry different degrees and amounts of power in our society. Right? That's the basic communication there. Now think of the way we sometimes react. Okay, so suppose there's another ouch situation where I bump into someone in the hall and they say, ouch. Okay? And I say, what do you mean, ouch? How dare you say ouch? Are you calling me an ouchist? You're just too sensitive. How dare you? Huh? We would know that something had gone radically wrong in that situation, right? But we accept this as a response in our culture, right? That I didn't mean anything. You're too sensitive. Notice what has happened. Whether or not the original comment was racist, sexist, whatever, oppressive in some way, the response, I didn't mean anything, is oppressive. Because the comment was about the person's experience. I got hurt, and here's why I think I got hurt. I've shifted it to a conversation about my intentions. Right? That's privilege. That's white privilege or male privilege or whatever it is. That even a conversation about racism turns out to be a conversation about the intentions of white folks. Because who else is worth talking about? What other conversation would we be having? If we remained human, if we were not consumed with all the guilt that comes with privilege, with all the dominator guilt, we would stay human. We would stay in relationship. Bump into someone in the hall, they say, ouch. We all know how we would respond. Sorry. It's not an admission of guilt. It's not a confession, I'm a terrible person. It's not even a statement I did anything wrong. We collided in a way that hurt you. Sorry. The next statement would be something like, where does it hurt? Can I help? Something. You stay in human relationship. The fact that we don't do this, that we get so deeply defensive and cannot have a conversation where we take in information about how someone else has been impacted by our actions, this is a sign of deep distress in our culture. And it's something those of us in dominant group identities need to work on and drop the defensiveness so that we can actually take in information and be educated about our impact in the world around us. And education is supposedly what we are here for. So it seems to me that dropping that defensiveness is an essential part of the goal. There's a whole bunch more we could talk about, but let me end with a quote, which is from a book that I am a co-author of, and I always make a point of saying my two co-authors did much more of the work on this than I do. There's a reason that I'm listed as the third author here. The book is White Men Challenging Racism, 35 Personal Stories. These are narratives of, we conducted them as interviews and then a little editing so they, you know, emerge as people telling their stories. And it's in what is called an annotated table of contents. We listed different chapters and a couple of words about who the person is, and then a quote from their narrative. So with all due deference to all my learned colleagues in the room, in religion, in theology, I say that my favorite theologian is now Bill Johnston, who was a former Boston police officer. When we interviewed him, he was living on Emerald Island in North Carolina. He was 60. And here's what Bill Johnston has to say, and this is the thought I will leave you with. He says, I have a vision that when we arrive at the pearly gates, we're going to find out that God is everything that we're not. If God made us all, then he is all of us. At my moment of death, the God who comes to judge me will be young, gay, Jewish, African American, and she is going to say, how the hell did you treat me? And I'll leave you with that, and thank you for your attention. So we have time for some conversation. Someone other than me should be watching the clock. So what's your pleasure? Oh, thank you. Here's the thing. We need to hold on to the principle that everybody is reachable. That's a matter of our empowerment. If you go around the world classifying people, this person I can talk to, this person I can't, this is going to take a lot of your mental energy to classify people, right? So I suggest we drop. Everyone is in principle reachable. That being said, we need to make practical, strategic decisions about the use of our time and energy. Right? You can't do it all. You don't want to commit this mistake of letting the squeaky wheel get the grease. You don't want to spend your time going after the worst offender. It's probably not a good use of your time. Though I've learned from colleagues who do this kind of work to try to think in concentric circles. You're not going to reach the worst offender. But they are reachable by their friends. And they are reachable by their friends. And at some point in these expanding circles, you're going to hit someone who is reachable by you. And then you encourage them to work inward. So that's how we make change. But it is important that we separate the principle that everyone is reachable from the unfortunate strategic decisions we have to make that, sorry, I don't have time to go after you right now. My time is better spent elsewhere. And that's an essential decision to make, but we need to be clear about the level at which that decision is being made. So the very important practical question. Thank you. I see it not working. I learned a long time ago that good therapy can still be bad politics. Huh? It can be very self-satisfying to call someone out. I told them the right thing to do. Right? Yeah. But as a teacher, here's one unusual source. The 17th century Swiss philosopher Jean-Jacques Rousseau wrote a book called Emile on education. And on the first page, he says, before educators think about what they want to teach people, you better first think about what people are capable of learning. Right? I can't tell you how many conversations I've had with colleagues who say, well, I taught this to the students, but they didn't learn it. And I want to go, no. Teaching and learning are reciprocal activities. If they didn't learn it, it means that you didn't teach it. You may have lectured, you may have pontificated, you may have done all sorts of things, but what you weren't doing is teaching. And we know that because they didn't learn. Right? So you have to see things from the point of view of the person you are talking to. So that's one source. That goes back ways. When I talked about teaching as listening, right? In the academy, we could have talked about Socratic method, we call it. Very similar. Idea. Teaching is a process of soliciting from the person what they in fact already know. Right? And people sometimes, when we're talking about social change, talk about the importance of consciousness raising. And I'm an educator. I don't minimize that there is some important information that would be useful to convey. But the real issue is empowerment, not consciousness raising. If people were empowered to act on what they already know, the world would be a much better place. So I have learned to put attention less on the cognitive elements and more on the emotional. That before you strive for the teachable moment, you need to have created the learnable environment. You need to have made a human connection that underlies the cognitive function. It's an occupational hazard. In the academy, we are in our heads. We consistently go cognitive, and we drop the affective, the emotional, the human component. I'm a parent. I certainly learned it from there. There are all sorts of other social movements, approaches. Most recently, I've been doing work at the University of Northern Iowa, a program called the National Coalition Building Institute. NCBI. I found that approach very valuable. That has both taught me new things and reaffirmed long-time understandings I had. So there are various reasons that I go there. Electronic media are not the ideal place for social change. They are a useful tool to connect people who are already like-minded. But in terms of change, you can't read body language, you can't communicate. It just has really, really limited usefulness. And it has contributed to the corruption of public discourse and our polarization and our inability to connect with each other. I'm talking about making social change. I'm talking about shifting attitudes. There are times when oppression is going on right in front of you when you don't have the luxury to engage in long-term strategy. There are times when it's necessary to call out and just say, this has to stop. I don't care what. At this moment, my priority is not why. At this moment, my priority is not reaching you as a person. There are times when that's necessary, particularly if you are the subject of the attack. Right? The first principle is protect yourself. Right? If I am being subject to mistreatment, I have no obligation to make myself an ally of the person who's abusing me. I do know people who will choose to do that at certain moments. I was in a conversation, there was a plan about a teach-in at my university about the Israel-Palestine question. I was talking to someone on the planning committee, and they were saying what was, to my mind, clearly anti-Semitic stuff. And I do not equate that with anti-Israel policy or anything like that. This was of a different order. And I could have said, you're no good anti-Semite, and stormed out. But I decided I wanted to work with this person on improving the event. So I probed, what do you have in mind? Why do you say that? And right after it, I had to go deal with all the emotions that this had stirred up in me. But I made a strategic choice at that moment to put my feelings apart. One is under no obligations to do that, right? So in the moment, particularly when you started by talking about media, that's probably not the ideal situation. I do believe that social change happens from the ground up. Here's a saying that a lot of people like that always sort of churns my stomach. It's a very popular quote from Margaret Mead, where she says, do not think that a small committed group of people cannot change the world. It's the only thing that ever has. Right? And I keep thinking, if that were true, the Titanic would still be afloat. Right? That's the tip of the iceberg. Right? It's the visible tip of the iceberg. If you look all out over the surface, that's what you see. But real social change comes from massive numbers of people mobilizing themselves. And that happens person to person. One of the things I go to is, can you tell me more about the history of your religion? Because people are taught their own religions as if they were always as they are now. And they weren't. I don't care what religion you're in, what denomination you're in. There was dissent on any issue you can think of. There was conversation. There were competing voices. And the most useful people, the most useful thing people can do is recapture their own history. So it's a little bit of a shift in tell me your story. It's more about, can you tell me your religion story? And maybe we can jointly investigate and find out the history here, because people will always be surprised. Our traditions are never as monolithic as we have been taught. Yeah. This is where the most self-empowered thing I can do is also the most empowering for others, is to accept the leadership of the affected group. If I'm asked, I'm happy to chime in, right, and say what I have to say. I owe my allies the best of my thinking, even if it disagrees with theirs, and we have a conversation, and I'm prepared to hear that I'm off. But it's a question of something I tried to say earlier, didn't have the time to really get into it. It's a question of taking leadership, of taking leadership from the oppressed group without in any way being self-deprecating. It's not like my opinion isn't worth as much, or you don't have as much to say. It's none of that. It's my empowered leadership is empowering the leadership of those directly impacted. And once again, it's mostly a listening task.